at least 47% of total voters with 9.4 million votes in hand, but politicians see more content chasing after young people, voters in swing counties and discontented tribes whose loyalties are changeable. Now, is this current young generation, I'm talking about youths between 18 to 35 years, in a position to change all that? Now, that's the discussion I'll be holding with my panelists right here in studio. Let me begin by introducing them to the far right, Jerono Odhiambo, an advocate, UNEP. Welcome to the program.
Thank you very much.
And right next to her, we have Samantha Maina, a social justice advocate. Welcome to the program
as well.
Thank you.
We're expecting Ruth Ambogo, a convener of a group called Daughters of Raila. She'll be joining us in studio shortly. Jerono, let me start with you.
Yes.
We started this segment about 2 months ago.
Mm-hmm.
We spent the time talking about how youth are discriminated in Kenya against, you know, by the political class. And of course, we define youth by Article 55 of the Kenya Constitution,
yes.
18 to 35. But even amongst youth,
yes.
There are those who say that there are different classes of discrimination even amongst the youth age set. Would it be politically correct to say that the average woman under 40 has to not only deal with discrimination as a youth, but also as a woman?
Yes. She has to deal with discrimination as a youth. She has to deal with the discrimination as a woman. And for her, it doesn't even stop at youth. The older she gets, the more discrimination she faces, even when she was young. And that's why representation matters at this point. Especially in the political arena, it would be really nice for us to see more women, so that in case, like, we have daughters, we know that this is what they can do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. They have something that they can aspire towards.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
Because you can't be what you don't see.
You can't. Are you sure you can't be what you don't see?
Most of the time.
Barack Obama would say different. Would speak differently.
Well, okay, true. But then, like, it would be nice. Now, you see, with Barack, how many black people, African American people, will ask for representation? Very many. So, yeah.
Fair enough. Samantha, mm-hmm. What's your take?
I think that yes, I do agree. If you're under 40 and you're a woman, there is straight up discrimination, but I think that shouldn't hinder you, especially if you're a woman, from trying to vie for office. I speak as someone who tried and yes, lost, but I got in there. I was brave enough to step in and just, you know what, I'm gonna try. I'm gonna demand my space. Yeah. So I think that it is true that, you know, when you're under 40 and you're young, it's hard.
You face greater challenges. We'll be looking at, you'll be telling us some of your experiences, I hope, in the course of this program.
Yes.
You've talked about people running for office and daughters looking at women who've gone ahead of them. Let's take a look at some of the statistics in terms of women who participated in politics in 2017. Can we run some of those graphics that should be coming up on your screen? And of course, talk to us. 2242 is our SMS line. And use the hashtag Power Breakfast or the hashtag The Young Turks to let us know your thoughts about this conversation. Let's take a look at the first graphic if we can now. Women in politics in 2017, 3 women governors elected, 3 women senators elected, 23 members of the National Assembly up from 16 that were elected in the previous parliament, the 11th parliament, and an estimated 100 members of the county assembly up from 84 in the 11th parliament. At the bottom, you can see where we sourced that data from. Let's take a look at the next slide and compare and contrast. That should be coming up on your screen shortly. Okay, there we go. 9.4 million women voters. That's 47% of registered voters. Now, youths aged 18 to 35, that's youths, men and women, account for 51% of all voters, up from 46% in the 2013 election. But how do we break down those numbers? And that's what you'll be seeing on the next slide when we take a look at all those youths, how many were men and how many were women. That should be coming up on your screen. All right, the number of women between 26 and 35 registering to vote increased 62% between 2017 and 2013. So the increase in youth is actually, in a sense, related to the increase in women, because the number of men within that same age set only increased by 50% between 2017 and 2013 as well. So an increase in the number of youthful voters in the country, that's undeniable. But if you look at that set of youthful voters, a greater number are women as compared to men. Do you agree with these statistics, Chirono?
Yes, I agree fully. Especially, I'm very impressed with the increase of the women voting, youth, because this shows that they want to be part of the party. They want to participate in this coming elections.
Mm-hmm.
They want to participate. They want to know who their leaders are. They want to know where their money is going. They want to know what bills are you passing in parliament. What about me? What about my reproductive health? And
Do you wish that the numbers were slightly higher?
Yeah.
When you look back, I know some were clapping and saying, look how well Kenya has done, but in East Africa, we're not actually doing that well. You cannot compare us with Rwanda, for example.
Yeah, that is true. But the thing is, with an increase, that means the next election, we should expect a better increase. And that's the same thing we want. We want women to have half of the share, on, especially in matters regarding politics. We want to be seen, want to be heard, because we have a lot of things we want to do on the ground. We want to work with Kenyans, want to make Kenya a better place for all genders. Because we've had a place where it was mostly male-dominated, but now because we want to see females, of course things will change. Yeah.
Okay, I like the fact that you're seeing the glass half full, rather than some would say still half empty. Samantha, as you look at those numbers, what are your thoughts? Are you happy with them? Can you say we can
clap
for Kenya in 2017?
No,
or not yet?
I think we still have a long way to go, but this is an improvement, as she's just stated. But my mind goes to, okay, out of the 62% of women between 26 and 35, were they aware of who they're voting for? Yes, we have an increase, but are we just increasing in number and not really voting in people who are going to go and represent us? So maybe that's just where my mind is going. An increase, of course, is absolutely positive. I hope that now it increases more, even 2022, but now we go into discussing, what do you have for me, right? What are you going to do when you get in there?
Okay.
It's just, yeah, I have my vote, but what does that mean?
What does that mean?
Yeah.
So it's not just enough to appreciate or applaud the fact that there are more women voters now, but are they, you know, making the right decisions when it comes to voting? That's a very good question. All right, so let's take a look at what some of the headlines from different articles had to say about women in politics in 2017, and those should be coming up on your screen shortly. I just picked random samples
from one or two local sites, and I think an international site as well. If we can put those up on the screen, just for the... Okay, the first one, this was by Oyunga Pala, a known writer. Women in politics, if you can... Yes, women in politics, not just a pretty face. And he says that the mistreatment of women in politics is as old as the Republic. A female politician has to fulfill the social requirements of the male gaze to succeed in this dirty game. So as a woman in politics, you either try to be the Mother Teresa or the Iron Lady. Basically, there's a nickname you'll be given depending on how you act. And he went on to reference how women, especially in Nairobi County, had to give themselves certain names, Mama Wanai, that sort of thing, for them to be endearing to the public and to voters as well. Whether that was necessary or not, again, Samantha, very curious to hear what your strategy was. Let's take a look and whether you felt that you had to, you know, operate, you know, brand yourself in a particular way to appeal to more voters. Let's take a look at some other headlines in regards to women in politics in 2017. All right, intimidation used to keep women from elective posts. This was the Daily Nation. I'm not quite able to catch the date from here, but giving different examples of, and so basically there were testimonies from different women politicians, those in office and those who tried to vie, about experiences they went through, intimidation, harassment of their voters. For some of the ladies, they're not even candidates, it's their husbands who are vying, so they'll join them on the political campaign trail, and they would be attacked in the process as well. And in this article, some ladies even asked the Inspector General of Police, we need special security. So intimidation, again, I'll get your take on that. Let's take a look at the next article. Okay, that should be coming up on your screen. Kenya's female voters could sway the presidential election. I'll be curious to know from you whether you agree with this statement. This was by Quartz Africa, and it talks about Kenya's 9.4 million female voters. In the battle for Kenya's presidency, the block of voters most neglected by the race's two main candidates, this is what the author feels, is the women's block, even though women are at least 47% of registered voters. And the author was concerned that politicians are more concerned with youth votes alone, voters in swing counties, discontented tribes, etc., and in a sense neglecting the female vote, and yet that could make all the difference. Do you think presidential candidates appeal to the female vote specifically? That's something we will be looking at. Let's take a look at the last article now. Women emerge strongly as political leaders in Kenya. Positive story here, written by UNDP Kenya. The authors, two of them, go into detail about what sort of gains have been made to allow women equal, I guess, platforms as men. They've talked about the two-thirds gender rule. They've talked about more women coming out to vie for positions and so forth. So a very well-written article that you can catch. Women strongly emerge as political leaders in Kenya. But of course, at the bottom, they've also talked about what needs to be done to improve on this. Ruth Ambogo now joins us. Welcome to the program.
Thank
I don't know if you've had a chance to take a look at some of the articles.
Yes, I have. I have just seen some of them.
Any that has, you know, struck your mind immediately as interesting, you agree, you disagree, what do you think?
The one that struck my mind is whether women voters would... whether women voters were expected to determine who would become the president. And for me, that's a question that's very close to my heart, because I think 2017 Kenyan politics proved to us that young women, and to be specific, well, women, and to be specific, young women, actually have an interest in politics. And it was a really interesting an interesting sort of, I don't know if it, I could call it a launch into politics, in the sense that I think the 2010 constitution kind of made it possible, or rather, you know, provided very many more platforms to which women can participate in the electoral process, by providing that we could have, you know, women representatives as a new creation of the constitution, by providing that we could also have not more than two-thirds being of the same gender in Article 81 of the constitution. That gave more women platforms to not only be involved in politics as elected members of parliament, but also as campaigners. So when we ask about the women vote having their ability to determine who becomes president or not, then we go to the question of how women participated in this entire campaign process. Mm-hmm. And this time round, I'll tell you for sure, women participated, especially young women. We saw both camps trying to actually appeal to the women vote, and not just appealing to them in the sense, oh, come out and vote for us, but we actually saw women forming, you know, lobby groups under this
one of which I think you belong to.
One of which I belong to. We saw, you know, the vibrant Daughters of Raila out there, you know, launching across the country, all over the country. We also saw a group by the Jubilee, you know, Women Brigade.
Yes.
You know, and even the other smaller candidates tended to try to appeal to young women to come on board and campaign for them.
Do you think presidential candidates, gubernatorial candidates, crafted their message to accommodate the woman voter? Did you see anything of the sort? Gerono disagrees.
I totally disagree, in the sense that especially at the presidential level, we really didn't see much coming from the major coalitions, the top coalitions. We only saw NASA at one point speak about the interests they had for the women who are single mothers and who are unable to take care of their families. I mean, it was, and we really also, personally as a woman, I didn't feel as if they gave out a clear plan as to what they were planning to do for these women. And yet we have very many categories of women out there in the society. We have the young woman who's going to campus. We have the woman who has just gotten into the job market. We have women who dropped out of school and therefore have nothing at all to do back at home. We have women who are suffering due to domestic violence. Mm-hmm. We didn't see them touch on these critical issues that, if addressed and if proper measures put in place to address, would ensure that the women agenda is pushed forward. And you know, there's one thing they say, that once you enhance the agenda of the women in the society, then the society is able to move forward.
Mm-hmm.
But their studies have shown, and there are also indicators of gender inequality indicators by the United Nations that show that a nation that reduces its gap on gender inequality, mm-hmm, is a nation that is able to steer forward in terms of development. So
clearly you came to the issue ready with your facts. I'll come back to you to get a bit more on that, Gerono. You can come in now. You're response to some of the articles that we've looked at?
Yeah, I'm interested in the last article, especially about the not more than two-thirds gender rule. So basically, it's been said in the constitution, they've said it in Article 27. They're saying, you guys are equal, you shouldn't be discriminated against, especially in the political sphere, in the economic sphere, in all of it, social and cultural.
Mm-hmm.
They say it again in Article 81b. They tell you, you people, you women should be given these seats. There should be not more than two-thirds gender rule. And currently, right now, as it is, the men are more. But what happens in future when we have more women? You see, the two-thirds gender rule will also apply then. There won't be more women than men. And we don't even want to deal with two-thirds. Why can't we have half-half representation?
And you reference that earlier.
Yeah, what is the problem with that? And then also, like she said, one thing, you cannot continue as a nation and talk about development and talk about how you're going to build stadiums, you're going to do all these things, and yet you have nothing put aside for the woman. You have nothing put aside for one gender, and they're always frustrated. So we should move towards, when we're having political debates, the woman should always be a topic, because we're
different. You don't feel that the declaration that women will get access to what, 30% of tenders together with youth, that
I haven't seen it work.
Okay.
And I'm very skeptical about it.
Okay.
Yeah, because okay. These things should also be in the open for us to know that it is possible for us to do this.
All right.
Yes.
It should be made transparent.
Very ETC. Transparent.
So
people should be accountable.
That hasn't worked at all.
I have not seen. I like the idea that now women are coming up. But you see, now it's like we're fighting against the forces that are already there. Like, men are telling us no, but we're saying we want it. Why? Because the constitution, which we voted in as all of us citizens of Kenya, it has things to do with gender equality. And we are a gender that has always been frustrated, especially in terms of representation. And we want representation. And we don't want it tomorrow. We want it now, today, so that it applies in our lives. Then we move on from there and deal with other issues.
Okay,
yes.
Okay. Samantha.
Mm-hmm. Well, yes, we were included, but to the point, to the extent where we're going to be given lessons and we're going to dance. And we're going to, I mean, there was nothing else for me. I felt like, okay, so we're being called and we're going to be celebrated. I mean, I did not understand where I was a priority. So yes, we were called upon, yes, but we're given lessons and all these things and go back home and then, you know, bring the vote. So that's where the inclusion for me
two elections.
Yeah. I mean historically.
Okay.
That's
okay.
Just what it's been.
Mm-hmm.
It's never been on a table where, okay, so what do you guys want? Then we begin to demand, this is what we want. We want this to pass through. We want proper health care for our children and all these things. But usually we're galvanized and we're put together for lessons, t-shirts, and dances, which, yeah. Anyway, so...
You described it quite appropriately. You also want to respond to some of the articles that we looked at?
Yes, there was one that...
That stood out for you?
Could we have swayed? Yes.
The presidential vote?
I think we could have, but I think even as women, we need to be more organized. I think we have some level of disorganization, and then so we begin to look beyond my tribe especially my tribe. So now we begin to look at issues that affect us. And then once we begin to agree on that, then we select presidential candidates, or whatever candidates, governors, whatever, and then we gauge them on, what do you have for me?
Okay.
Again, it has to be issue-based. I have to benefit, right? It's not just, again, lessons and t-shirts.
I want to come and get your personal experience in this past election, but
right.
Ruth, you wanted to come in, like, allow you to come in, then come back to you, Samantha.
Yes, I would want to, in a way, disagree with the statements that, you know, women were only involved to the level of being given out lessons,
receiving freebies.
And, yes, and I think it's in a way trying to say that women cannot also just organize and say, this is the preferred presidential candidate that we want, and we are going to, you know, move forward without even expecting to be given or, you know, given out handouts. Because I personally, my experience, and I might not want to mention which camp I was in, but then in my experience in the camp that I was in, first and foremost, we self-organized. Nobody came and told us that, you know, come together and we are going to fund you and we will give you this material. We are going to, you know, people came together and people said, look, we prefer to have this presidential candidate elected. So what do we do? We are going to mobilize funds. We are going to fundraise. We are going to ensure that, you know, we speak out on the issues affecting women, so that even as we are on the campaign trail, as we are being recognized as providing more substance to his campaign, then we are also going to have our issues heard out. And several times, because of our presence in the country, we were actually called to meetings and asked, exactly what do you guys need? And I think that's the direction that women...
It wasn't the other way around, where they first called you, what do you need?
We mobilized, we realized the potential that we did have, we realized the power that we had to influence the voters, we realized the kind of input we could add to the national politics, and we got out there. Then when we got out there, then our voice was heard, then we became relevant, and then that's when we were called. And I think women need to realize that we do have that power, we do have that potential. And, you know, I think we shouldn't limit politics to the national level of politics, where when we were electing the presidential candidates, we need to also calm down and ask ourselves, what role did women play in the election of female governors? For instance, in the three counties that female governors were elected, did these female governors consider the women agenda at the forefront? I think these women, if you ask me, tend, in a way, won the elective executive seats because in a big way, the women in their constituencies, in their counties, contributed to their win in terms of voting for them. And we have seen these women coming out strongly within their first 100 days and actually focusing on issues affecting women. We see Governor Charity Ngilu already launching health projects, talking about water how she's projects. Going to, yes, water projects, mm-hmm. talking about how she's going to revive 60 dispensaries in her county, speaking of how she's going to have more nurses, 60 nurses employed in all these dispensaries, already engaging with international communities, with donor organizations to bring in funds, and most of her activities, in a way, even though they are going to benefit the general community, she tends to put the women at the forefront mm-hmm. because she understands that when the healthcare system does not work, most people who are affected are women mm-hmm. and children
yeah,
and
they carry the burden.
Yes, they carry yeah. the burden of healthcare. And also we are seeing Joyce Laboso, governor, coming out clearly and launching, you know, cleaner projects. According to her, she's saying that, you know, a cleaner city attracts more investment. And we're even seeing women representatives already working out on, we've seen, I think Waiguru also cut out a deal when the nurses were striking.
That's
so
right.
Basically, women have the power to change the politics of this country, and I don't think we should be talking about this topic as if our influence as women has ended and, you know, the campaigns are over and that's it, let's wait for the next 5 years. Because people, young women who participated in this political process, many of them have ended up being appointed either as executive committee members in the county government. Many of them have become employed by some of these politicians, and therefore we are hoping that they will be able to drive the agenda of women inclusivity in politics. It does not end at the campaign stage.
Mm-hmm.
It continues, and we expect to see what these women are going to do.
Mm-hmm.
We expect to see, because in some counties I understand that the number of women MCAs who had been elected in 2013, you know, the number kind of went down because these women did not show anything for
mm-hmm.
you know, for
mm-hmm.
what they had done. And also we
although
saw
there was a general increase, but I know
there was
a
general increase.
Some who should have retained their seats,
yes,
were sent
yeah, because
they
did not show any track record. And I think 2017 was a good enough indicator that women, even though elected, need to prove themselves, you know, 5 years later, what
not
have
automatic.
You done?
You're
it's
right.
not automatic.
Okay.
Yeah,
Just on what she's saying about women not showing, I agree with everything she says, by the way, and it's really beautiful to see that. But then the not showing, women not showing their track record, especially in parliament, women are held to a higher standard. There are so many scandals we've had in the past about politics and, you know, how our wealth of the country is going, but then women are always held to a higher standard, which is really unfair. So you find that men all along have been messing up. They have done the worst things you could even think of. But then when it comes to a woman, like for example, talking about Waiguru, when she was the CS, it was such a big issue because they said, oh, she had stolen funds, this is what she had done. But then at the end of the day, men have been doing these things all along.
They have been scandals.
But I don't see anybody coming
all through the year.
Yeah, to hang them. Like their careers are not ridiculed. They don't go through that process. So as much as what we really want for now is the representation. For me, that is what is key, because already scrutinizing what people go to do in parliament, I feel like for me as an advocate or as a lawyer and what I've studied and what the constitution says, it doesn't matter about your characteristics, your personal issues. We need representation, and we want it to be not more than 2/3 of one gender.
Okay.
And so if we have already a third of the gender being frustrated and they're not represented, we need to fix that. Because the constitution says if that's not what is going to happen, what happens, parliament tends to be unconstitutional.
Are you concerned, however, that both sides of the political divide, although they've spoken about it,
yeah.
have not shown that enthusiasm that they show for other matters
yes.
when it comes to the 2/3 gender
yes.
rule?
Yes, and that is the most disappointing thing ever. It's like when we talk about the 2000 gender rule, people will be like, oh, ni kelele, oh, ni feminism. And you're wondering, this is about my life as a woman. You as a man will never be in my shoes. But then you want to go to parliament, you'll see a reproductive health bill, and you'll say, wacha yo ikae kando kwanza, let's deal with the roads and development. But you're hurting me. But you can't see that, and that's why we're saying if you can't see as a man, let's bring the woman to sit here and show you people that this is also important. So when you want to put it aside, they're like, there's also this. You need to deal with this. You need to deal with reproductive health. You need to deal with the surrogacy issues we're being fought, because we're supposed to move together as a nation. We don't see big stadiums and all these roads and everything and trains. That's good also. But then, how will I come to the train, to how will I be using your roads if already I'm at home and bedridden, because reproductive health already is an issue. Abortion is an issue. Everything dealing with gender is an issue. And then that's where men want to speak. But when they're speaking, what are they? They're being dismissive.
If you were to point a finger at exactly why, in your opinion, the two-third gender rule has not been implemented, what would you say is the main reason from where you sit?
I'm telling you, people have fought for this gender bill, but you will not see it. First of all, there were three bills. There was the Chepkonga bill, then there was the Honorable Dwale bill, and then there was something called the compromise bill. And all these were tabled in parliament so that they could change. Because you see, for the county, they have a two-third already set. They have principles. It's written in the constitution how they'll do it. So the Chepkonga bill was saying that, well, we should deal with it, the two-thirds, not more than two-thirds gender rule, progressively. So we add the word progressive, meaning it should go in the future. But we refuse.
Implementation.
Yeah, we refuse because the constitution is giving us these rights now, not later. And then also, we have the compromise bill which was saying, okay, fine, let's give women the numbers, but to appease the men so that they pass the bill, let's just minimize the number for the women. But that is also unconstitutional. And the Dwale bill was saying, let's take this section that deals with the county and then we place it to deal with also the Article 97 to deal with the national assembly. And then we fought for the bill. Women in parliament took their men out for dates. They tried to sway them this side, that side. Nobody was interested, and it failed. It failed and failed miserably. And on that day, I was so depressed as a nation, because you work so hard just to... We have hashtags. We have all these things. Why aren't people taking them seriously?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And is it because we are female?
I'll come back to you to talk a little bit about women have to take men for dates to get votes.
Yeah.
Do men have to do that when they want support from the women? And I'll come back to you for that. Samantha, can give you a chance to comment before I ask you about your personal experience. Do you want to comment on anything they've said?
I'll say that it's lack of political goodwill on the part of two-third gender rule not being passed.
Yeah.
It's that simple. Yeah, I mean, when it comes to other issues, say even salary increment, you can see the house is full and there's such a unity amongst all of us. When it comes to the two-third gender rule, it looks like it's a woman issue, and it's not. Again, as she stated, it's a gender rule. So at whatever point when we are dominant, when the woman is dominant, then the male will have, the two-third gender rule will also play in their favor. Yes. So that's all I had to comment to her.
Okay,
yes.
Short and sweet. You vied for a position to be a member of the County Assembly in Nairobi County for our viewers who may not know.
Yes.
I want to read you two headlines from two Nairobi publications to get your view on whether this was a challenge that you faced on the campaign trail. One headline from the Nairobi News had a blazing title, "Beauties for Women Rep Seat Who Nairobi Men Cannot Stop Ogling At."
Oh, wow.
Okay? Photos attached to, as you click to want to watch. Another one, tuko.co.ke went to the clickbait, "Meet the beautiful women's rep aspirants everyone is talking about."
Mm-hmm.
Click for photos. Did you feel pressure to come off in a certain way, to use the sex appeal card to get more voters? Tell us about your personal experience.
No, I did not. And even my hashtag was not Bay of something or Msupu of something, because I do not think that I need to sexualize myself so that I can appeal to you, right? If you do find me beautiful, thank you very much, but I bring more to that. So I never found the need to come and say, oh, I am this, I'm beautiful for this, or I'm Mrembo for this. I came with issues and said, you know what, I'd like to ask you for your vote to get me into the county assembly, and then this is what we're going to do. So I never felt the pressure to do that. I was actually against it. Anyone who even tried to put a hashtag, I remember part of my campaign team was like, let's try and use Bewakile. You should have seen me. I'm like, no. We are not about, I'm not about to be a bae of anything. I'm Samantha. And it's going to be Samantha for Kileleshwa. But I didn't feel the pressure. I was actually against it.
Are you concerned that sections of the media would, sell such an agenda?
But
that,
it's what
that even
sells.
Such discussions would come up in your campaign team. That shows that clearly there are those who feel that such strategies would work.
But of course, I'm sure that they do work. There's a way that you can appeal to. But that was not my intention. Mine was not to be a sex symbol. No. I was going there to be a representative. And fine, I'm beautiful. Okay, yes, thank you very much. And then what, right? I did not want to be sexualized into anything.
Okay.
Yeah.
Ruth?
You see, it's unfortunate that we had political parties and
We even had political parties that would intentionally go for beauty in the name that, you know, in during nominations, because they thought...
Wait, you have
yes, I actually had cases of women who were saying that some political parties, especially for MCA positions in Nairobi, would go for beauty because they knew beauty would sell. And it's unfortunate that women have to be reduced to that level of sexual scandals. And in a sense, some of these women even tend, no offense, to go the way of bringing up their own scandals, you know, that are sexual related, to be able to gain them viewership and to give them political mileage and to put them out there on the map. It's also unfortunate that society views women as sexual objects, you know, the more beautiful you are, the more votes you will get, and that our politics has been reduced from the politics of values and issue-based politics to who looks better than who. And you see, we need to get to the level whereby we begin to look at women from the substance of what they are presenting to the table. Are you able to bargain for our rights? Are you able to sit to the table and say this is what women want, rather than, you know, just putting out there how well you look, how good you look? We've seen progressive countries especially Scandinavian countries, where you have a whole country that the prime minister is a woman, the chief justice is a woman. I don't know if it's Sweden or it's which country, but the prime minister is a woman, very young. The chief justice is a woman, and I think the head of government or some position that is equivalent to I don't know, but the top three leadership is women. And these women don't go out there campaigning on the basis of this is, you know, this person, this woman looks more beautiful than the other. And when we begin to reduce our politics to who looks more beautiful than the other, that's where we lose it. Because then 5 years later, we start asking ourselves, did we vote for beauty or what? You know, did we vote for values, or did we vote for someone who all they did was come and show us how well they look? And so I think now that's where the whole question of even the two-third gender debate comes in. In 2013, when women were trying to run for bigger seats such as governors, they were told, you know, you women fit to you should either wait, you know, support male candidates so that you can become nominated. And I think it also happened in this other election, especially in counties that are in the Mashinani areas. Women were being told, you know what, support the male candidates, you shall be nominated, you're beautiful enough, why do you want to be involved in politics? And this kind of sexism does not only apply to women candidates, but it also applies to women who are trying to involve themselves in the political space. I personally have faced it in the past. I have been in situations whereby you're going for serious political meetings, and you know, the funny thing about these political meetings is many of them tend to run very late into the night. Most political decisions are made at 1 a.m. in some very dingy places in Nairobi, and you have to, you know, you're a woman, you're asking yourself, what about my security?
What am I doing there?
So you're going for a serious political meeting thinking, okay, so I'm going to add value to this discussion. And then you get there, when serious matters are being discussed, you're told, so you can have your juice and sit at the side. I've had that happen to me once. And therefore you ask, and then you know, the thing is, you look at yourself and you look at the role you're going to play after all these political discussions have been made, and you realize the role you're going to play is actually very critical. You know, you're going to play a very major role in these discussions. But when serious discussions are had, you're told, you know what, you're a woman, you can sit. They don't tell you you're a woman, but they tell you you can sit on the side. When you are done having this discussion, we'll bring you to the table.
And you understand why they are telling you. They may not say it explicitly,
exactly.
But you understand
I once had that experience, and you know, it made me realize, look, I'm not even a candidate for this election. I'm not even, you know, I haven't even put myself out there that I'm running for a seat. How about the women who have put themselves at the forefront? And you know, the moment we begin to sexualize women, that's when you see women being harassed even sexually on the campaign trail. I have a friend of mine who ran for MCA position in Nairobi in 2013, and she swore never to run again for elections ever in Kenya. Why? Because at one time when she was on the campaign trail, she was dressed up in a skirt, and somebody literally tried to pull down her skirt. And since then, she got so scared, and it's not just one, two friends. Since then, she got so scared, she said she can never be involved in campaigns, in politics, and she said, you know what, let me just focus on doing NGO work. This is not my field, this is not my game. We've had women who've been sexually harassed on the campaign trail, and not just women who are running for seats, even women who are campaigning for these aspirants. So it's a very serious issue that needs to be addressed, and I think that's where the question of even implementing the two-third gender principle comes in.
Really,
you know?
Comes in.
Yeah.
Gerono, I have another question for you, but I can give you a chance to respond.
Yeah, now
first.
This is one thing. How unfair is this? Has anybody ever gone to see the presidential candidates, and because they're male, and say, oh, this one is more good looking than this one. Maybe let's just put him there. They're not looked at on their beauty. They're not looked at whether they have wives or kids or whether they go to the kitchen. No one cares about those things. But when it comes to women, it's a different ballgame. Then this is the beauty of feminism. If a woman wants to say, she knows she can bring a lot to parliament. She knows she just needs to get there. If she's going to play as dirty as the men do and use her beauty, use her whatever she needs to do and appeal to the vote, I'm okay with that. For me, what is more important is she going to be on the seat and is she going to work? You see, so I agree, I appreciate Samantha because she decided that's not her role. And I appreciate the women who decided to go with the hashtag for Bay because that's how they wanted to represent themselves. And if they got there because of that, good for them.
You're not concerned that by representing themselves that way, that they then, you know, in a sense, gave their perception that's how all women need to campaign?
No, it's not about that. My point is, we cannot use that one woman standard and apply it to all the women. That is really unfair because we do not do the same for the men. It's not, the game is as dirty as it is. So that's how they're playing. That's how, because as in that's how they're trying to appeal to the public. That's how they're trying to appeal to their voters. I don't have a problem with that because politicians already lie to us. They'll tell us they'll build this amount of things, but they won't do it. But there's no one who could go and tell the next politician, male, who says the same thing that you see this other person said the same thing, you are saying the same thing, so we want to vote for you.
So if I can catch your point before she comes in, because she clearly has a fight on her hands. If a male candidate was to try to sell themselves off as a sex symbol,
no,
it would not be applied to all men.
Exactly.
But unfortunately for women, if just one woman tries to sell herself off as a sex symbol on the political trail, then the expectations are that all other women, then that's the fear, I think, that she has.
No, let me tell you, Waiguru, for example, using her, they say she did this. Oh, look at when you put women in power, look at what they do. There's a scandal behind her. She's done all these things. But now let me ask you, that's what they used to say. We cannot put women in power. This is what you people do to our fans. But really, is she the first person to have a scandal? And see how far it was taken because she was a woman. And that's my point. We are not on the same playing field. So if a woman decides that for her to garner votes,
she has to do something strategy. Unconventional.
That is her strategy.
Briefly, Ruth, because I need to bring Samantha in.
I have a problem with that because remember that time when before the nominations, before now we knew which political party had picked which female candidate to run for women rep, especially in Nairobi. There was this time when all of them would go to media houses for interviews and they would raise very serious points. They would come up with very serious issues that they were planning to, you know, to implement in Nairobi if elected. But what would the discussion be on Facebook and on WhatsApp and on all, you know, social media platforms? It would be about how, oh, this was a show whereby we were being shown who is wearing the most expensive wig, and yet they would raise very serious issues. And some of these women are women who have higher political ambitions. There are women who would want to run for governor at some point. There are women who would even want to run for president at some point. The moment they now finish their women rep, you know, politics, and now it's 2022 and they want to run for governor, the same perspective that they will have laid down in 2017 is the same measure upon which they will be judged. They will be told, you know, this is not a beauty contest. And that is what happened in 2013 when many women were trying to run. They were told, look, this is not a beauty contest, go and run for women representative. And you know, and that's why I think even the position of the women representative was demeaned from 2013, because people would say, these women got here because it was a beauty contest, let them contest it out there. And when serious issues are being discussed, nobody pays attention. Why? Because it's a beauty contest. And even
so
after being elected,
in a nutshell, you disagree with
yes, I disagree with it, because and you see, that is what, if that's the standard, if we become okay with it, it's the same standard that women will be used to be measured by when they are seeking for even corporate positions. They will be told, look, this is not a beauty contest, this is a contest of brains, and therefore we get locked out. We already have too many barriers. We already have too many barriers. We already have too many cultural cultural practices that are hindering women to get into
barriers,
leadership. So when you add sexism on top of it, you're just locking it out. The playing field stops being.
I'm going to give you a right completely. To reply just a bit. Samantha, you want to come in?
I just want to say that I respectfully disagree. I think that cannot be what it is we set it out to be. Because again, I'm just thinking about my younger sisters or, you know, nieces who are looking at me and thinking that, okay, I have to appeal in a certain way. If I have to be sexualized for me to get into office, be it political or to climb up a corporate ladder, then there's something wrong with that. And that messaging is very wrong. I think that we can just, I can, yes, be beautiful, you know, wear the weaves that you want to wear, dress the way you want to dress, you know, but it's beyond that. It has to be beyond, it has to be, okay, what do I bring on the table? And once you can see that, I want you to judge me on that. Not because, I don't know, I can wear, you know, lipstick and other things. I think that kind of narrative is very dangerous if we adopt it.
Yeah.
I agree.
The narrative is dangerous. I am not refuting. What I'm just saying is, like you see what Samantha said, that her sisters, her relatives will look at her in a certain way. But I'm saying this again. The men, how come the men don't have that standard? How come no one is saying, oh my gosh, Kidero, sorry to say, slapped some woman. So now you see, men shouldn't vote, we shouldn't have men in parliament because they are abusive. No one looks at men that way. Why are women being held to this ridiculous standard?
So should
and that's another thing. Another thing is, we're not here to please men. That's one thing. We're not here to please men, we're not here to... Who are trying to please is the citizens that we're going to fight for. So for example, if I decide to look beautiful, if I decide to go with the beauty hashtag, and if I decide to go to parliament and then I bring forth bills that will help the women, I don't see why somebody shouldn't be voted in just because of that. You see, as in what I'm trying to say is, you're doing it for... How you present yourself, how you want people to vote you in, that is fine, you're doing it for yourself. This narrative we have where women should be looked at differently, so that when you go there, they're like, oh, this is not a beauty contest. Well, that is the seat you'll have then.
Watch
your power.
In a sense, if men can use any means possible...
Possible. Women should... Seat, why exactly? I don't see... That's ridiculous double standard to me.
But like... Wahiga, the problem with that is this, yeah? Then what happens to the woman who is not necessarily, by the standards of the voters, beautiful? What happens to her, and yet she has a clear agenda for her people? Does that mean that she should then lose because she is not beautiful as per the standards? And you know, when we start accepting such standards, when we start accepting such slogans and say, okay, fine, this is not the standard that is expected, men, I mean, the same standard is not applied to men, then we need to begin to set the right standards that would apply to everybody, so that it is not that if it is not applying to men, then if women choose to go by it should be okay. You know, Sheryl Sandberg says that, you know, at some point we will not have female leaders, but we shall only have leaders. And if we start adopting standards such as the beauty, and we say that, okay, well, it does not apply for men, why is it that men are not held at such a standard? Does that mean that if men are not held at the standard of beauty, then women should be held by the same standards? No. Women should begin to sit down and say, look, at some point in the future, it will not matter whether you're a woman or not, it shall not matter whether you're a man or not. At some point in the future, we shall have women actually coming up and standing for presidential candidates in this country and actually garnering votes to become the president. And I wait to see that day, not just as a viewer, but as a participant in even wanting to become the president at some point. At some point, the standards will...
Shared your personal ambition.
Yes. Okay. At some point, all these barriers will have to be broken. What standards will apply then? Shall it be whoever displays the highest amount of corruption shall be the one who shall win? Shall it be whoever is more beautiful is the one who shall win, or whoever is more handsome? We need to begin to set the standards right. If it is not applying for women, if it does not apply to the men, then it should not apply to the women as well. And then women should be able to sit down and say, then what standards should we then put forth? If the beauty standards does not apply to male politicians, it shouldn't apply to the women politicians as well. We should all sit down as a society and say, look, we are not going to elect you on the basis of how beautiful you are, but on the basis of what values you put forth and what ideas you come up with.
I don't know if you still want to respond, but she also posed an interesting thought there. A day will come when we no longer have to have a discussion like this.
Politics.
When do you think that day will be in Kenya?
In Kenya, probably. Like we said, we had started with statistics that talked about like voting. As long as we have people like Samantha and Ruth, why should we have a problem?
And you?
Yeah, okay, yes, and me. Let me tell you what my interests are. My interests are seeing these women represent us. That is what I have vowed my life to be. And to know, like the Constitution says this. So what should we do? We should do what the Constitution says. So we have Samantha, we have Ruth. And these are the people I'm saying, look, the Constitution says you need to run. So do it, because I have no political aspirations. But trust me, if I had those ambitions of being a president, and I knew I could get it in this certain way, I would use that way to get it. You can judge me now on the work I do later. So I understand what they're trying to say, but I'm also saying you should give women the respect or the right, give her her dignity, let her do what she wants to do to get where she wants to get. Because it's the same way with your strategy. People will tell you, why aren't you using the beauty tag? Why aren't you doing it this way? Because you have your rights, and your rights are, I want to use this type of strategy. So the women who are also using the beauty, you know, one thing you should not forget is they are on the same side with us. They are also suffering as we suffer. They are just using another way. So we want to see, are they going to be, if that will take them to parliament, my work will be done, because all I see is representation, and then the work they do after that.
In 2022, we expect to see a lot more women coming out to vie
and
for
young women.
If all of them choose to follow the beauty hashtag, the hashtag this and that,
no,
would that be a
you're not getting me. What I'm saying is, whatever strategy they decide to use, I will support them. That is all I'm saying.
Okay.
So if they decide to use beauty, it might come to a detriment. It might have disadvantages later, but as long as they're inside, we will deal with those disadvantages. Because for now, what for me is key is representation.
So get them in.
Get them in. Because the men have been in. No one has asked them about beauty. They've been corrupt. No one has asked them about corruption. So let us get in, and then we see the difference we can bring. And trust me, women will bring a difference. You people will regret why you never used to vote women in from the beginning. Why we don't have female presidents?
Okay, okay. Samantha.
No. Yes, you shall regret. I absolutely agree with that. No. I mean, I'm beginning to see your point, but she has really put a strong case. She has, and she's convincing me, which is not a good thing. But I'm not against what it is you're saying.
Yeah.
Again, it's a strategy that you use, and I personally am opposed against that strategy because it's not a strategy that we should be looking to do. To have just going forward. But also, you mentioned about 2022, we'll have more women, and I hope they come out.
They will.
Please come out. You don't even have to be perfect.
Especially your camera, you seem to want to make an appeal.
Yes, it is. I know, because, you know, society tells us that we have to be perfect or attain, say, marriage, or we have to attain a certain look or a certain body size. You know, how a woman is trivialized to such basic things. My appeal to you, young woman, who feels that, you know what, in 2022 you have something to offer, just be brave and do it. Come out. You will figure it out on the way. I mean, when I started off last year, September, I was clueless, right? And then I sought out advice. I sought out to see, okay, what it is I can pick from people who've gone ahead of me and those that are willing to mentor me. So just come out. I'm sure there are women in these spaces that will just even hold your hand. But come 2022, I'd want to see just more of us. Not even just participating in terms of vying, but also that we get elected. That even you as the electorate, give us a chance, you know?
Off topic, will you vie again?
Yes, I will.
And if you will, what have you learned that you'll do differently that you wish you had done before August 8th?
I'll start early. I think that's the best I could. I would start my campaigning early.
Okay.
Between now and then, we do have things even together in my political party, just to, you know, to cement my name, because I realize that you're dealing with, especially coming from a small party, which is a Ukweli party, it was very hard to break the NASA and the Jubilee.
Yes.
Right? Because I was so dominant. It got to a point even when you're campaigning, they're like, if you're not Tuko Pamoja, if you're not, you know, Baba, then no way are we even going to listen to you. And also forcing me to give a stand. I wasn't for any of the two.
Or certain points you asked, which side
It didn't even matter what it is I was telling them. No. Uko na Baba ama you with Tuko Pamoja. I'm like, uko juu. Neza chagua. But nipe MCA, I'll work with whoever is in office, you know. So, I mean, it has to move beyond that. For me, even going forward, we have to move where, can we just have a rainbow nation in there? Can we not just have one political party dominating, right? So I think it's important to have yes and no people to keep you more objective. So yes, to your question, I will vie again, yes.
for another seat or?
No.
Okay.
I'll stick to MCA. Let me at least clinch that one. Yeah. Then I can go up the ladder.
Okay. I feel like we just started this discussion, but my director tells me that our time is actually up.
Oh.
So I need to give you each 30 seconds to give you the closing remarks. I know we've just scratched the surface. Hopefully I can get you back all again and we can carry on. We haven't even looked at statistics of women in employment in the workforce vis-a-vis men and so much more. But Ruth, briefly.
Okay, quick one. Women still have a long way to go to break the proverbial glass ceiling, which is basically the barriers that have prevented women from attaining standards of leadership where they would be more productive, where they would be more visible, where they would be able to bring effective change. We know that if you're not seated at the table, then you're on the menu being discussed. So we need to have more and more women sitting at the table deciding what needs to be discussed for the benefit of women, for the benefit of children, for the benefit of persons with disabilities. I've always maintained the position that when you have more women in leadership, then you have most of these issues addressed, such as, you know, the issues affecting the vulnerable in the society, the young people in the society, the women in the society, the elderly in the society. So we need to have women agenda, especially as regards the implementation of the two-third gender principle, really taken seriously. It is a constitutional provision that we approved the moment we were approving the constitution. It is unfortunate that it is the only clause of the constitution that has not been implemented, and yet we fully gave ourselves the whole constitution. It's sad that this was supposed to be implemented years back, and yet we still have, you know, a lack of political goodwill and scaffolds right, left and center. We know that implementing the two-third gender principle has been proven that would only require an extra 54 shillings of the taxpayers' money every other year, which is a very, very minimal cost, considering the level of corruption we have in this country, considering the level of scandals that go on in this country.
54 shillings?
Just an additional 54 shillings on the taxpayers' money per year. On each taxpayer.
Okay,
that's a very minimal cost per year to implement the two-third gender principle. We need to have political goodwill to implement this so that we can prove to our young women and women like me who have ambitions of one time becoming the president of this country
and
that, you know what,
again.
We can actually make it.
I love it. Yeah, okay. I love it.
go ahead, Gerona.
Yeah, so one thing people should know is that we as women, we've never been interested in being invisible and we've never been interested in being erased. So all I'd like to say is the constitution gives you the right. And if you're a woman out there, please, if you have political aspirations, go vote. I mean, go register yourself as a voter, as a candidate. And then also, we will vote for you. That is what we're interested in. Because the Constitution says that you have this right. So go use it. It's your right. And we will fight for you the whole way. Whatever bills we need to write, we will do them. If we need to amend the Constitution, I hope it doesn't come to that, or declare this parliament unconstitutional, we will do it for you. So women, you're on the right track. Let more of us come.
Okay. And Samantha?
I mean, she just took the words out of my mouth.
Okay.
I will just put a stamp on what she said.
Okay.
Just come out and yes, we'll figure it out.
Yeah.
Just come out.
All right. That's how we wrap up this discussion. Let's take a look at a couple of SMSs. I'll read the more controversial one towards the end, just because my guests might want to come in. Someone, you don't give us your name, but you say women in politics, there should be more voter education to women. Sir Nixon Dugire from Kindaruma says, other than underrepresentation of women and low priority on issues important to women, is there other evidence that the current system is not working well and needs to be reformed? While Amos Correa asks, I think men are becoming gradually endangered in the sense that women have been given too much priority. That's what he feels. In addition to the women's seat preserved for them, they can still duel with men on other seats. Boy child is now becoming more endangered than the girl child. Thank you. I wish we had time. I think it should have been
good. Where is the controversial
one? The last one.
Yeah, boy child. That is very controversial.
Then in that case, that's how we wrap up. Thanks for watching. We'll do this again next week, Wednesday, 6 to 7.30. Alternative voices from the people that have been dominating TV talk shows ever since we got into this election period. And I think we're bringing fresh topics that need to be discussed to the public, to the public's awareness. We take a quick break now. Cheche continues on the other side with Fred Indimuli. You're watching Citizen TV. Keep it right here.